Hello, I'm Dr. Bridget Nash, and I'd like to welcome you to The Therapy Show. The purpose of this podcast series is to help a person or their family member navigate the mental health system. Dr. Justin Capote is a psychiatrist with extensive experience working in psychiatric emergency departments. Going forward, I will just use the term psych ER or crisis when talking about this level of service. Dr. Capote, from your experience working in community hospitals in the tri-state area, what are some of the main reasons someone would come to a psych ER?
Well, there's a number of reasons somebody would come and seek emergency psychiatric services. One of the first things that comes to mind, of course, is suicidal thinking. If you've ever called an outpatient, a psychiatrist or therapist, it's usually the first thing on the outgoing message is, if this is an emergency, go to your local emergency room. So when patients are in psychiatric crisis, that would be a reason to go. Other reason, adverse medication reactions, severe allergic reactions would be a reason to go. Acute psychosis, any sort of acute psychiatric symptomatology, panic attacks might get somebody there. Like I said, hallucinations, aggressive behavior, confusion, delirium, which you often see in elderly patients, substance abuse, detox. Very often people will seek emergency services for detox because they're not able to get into outpatient facilities.
And there's also like a major stressor. Like let's say there's a person who was experiencing a separation from a spouse. I've seen that in the emergency room.
Somebody dies recently, something sort of traumatic, an assault, any sort of trauma, that would certainly land you in the emergency room or could.
So what might a person expect to happen to them in a psych ER?
I think, and you sort of see this with people who have never been to a psychiatric emergency room, and you sort of contrast that to the behavior of people that actually present often, which is sort of another whole topic. But I think once you get there, you'll notice it's not a very nice looking place very often. It's a locked ward, number one. So once you're led into the patient area, which is usually a couple of rooms surrounding the nurse's station, you'll know that you can't get out. The doors are heavy and they are locked behind you. There's very often also a guard on duty, either right outside the door or sometimes stationed in the nurse's station by the patient rooms. If you got a window, it's probably small and very hard to reach and barricaded pretty well. And you understand, I mean, these are safety precautions. The toilets, the sinks are usually fitted with different kind of fixtures so that people can't take them off and use them as weapons, either on someone else or themselves. It can be kind of jarring. And I think if you haven't been there, oftentimes you sort of see the flight to recovery. People will go there because of a stressor. And when you finally get to them, they go, no, I'm fine. I just need to leave now.
So what kind of mental health professional would they expect to meet?
So beyond aesthetics, I guess it's a variety of experiences that people might get. They're probably going to be assessed by a mental health professional at first, an MHP or whatever the acronym is in your area. But somebody with either a college degree, a social work degree, a master's degree, but someone with some sort of a therapy or mental health background, that's the first person that you'll see. They'll do what's called the intake. And they may sit with you for however long it takes to get the story. And then they'll generally run that with the MD or DO or PA, NP, whoever's sort of quarterbacking the emergency room that day. And then you'll be evaluated by that person. That's generally going to be a shorter evaluation. It might not be, depending on the nature of why you're there. But that's going to be the person that generally handles any ordering. So someone that will put in any medication that you need or admission orders or ultimately discharge orders.
And that would be like a psychiatrist or like an advanced practice nurse?
Yeah, I know that the field is employing the use of advanced practice nurses, I think a lot more. Sometimes psychiatrists are few and far between, depending on where you're at. But generally, somebody with prescribing privileges, ordering privileges, will then see the patient and make a decision on whether they can go or whether they need to stay.
And then also medications.
And then medications, that's right. Anything that needs to be ordered.
So depending on the psychiatric evaluation, what are some of the possible scenarios a person might experience while they're in a psych ER?
You kind of see the ER as a front line between the inpatient side of things and the community. The ER is sort of there to triage crises and emergencies. Are these psychiatric or medical problems that really can't be managed safely on the outside in an outpatient setting, and that's somebody who needs to be admitted to the hospital or not? When it comes to psychiatric admissions, the way I generally teach it, I think you're looking for three criteria. I think people need to meet three particular things, and it gets a little subjective. It's the presence of acute psychiatric symptoms, right? And number one, if they're there for belly pain, that's not a psychiatric emergency, unless, you know, you determine that it's psychosomatic or something else or whatever. But in any case, so the presence of psychiatric symptoms, severe and persistent psychiatric symptoms that are causing an inability to function. This is the dangerousness to self or others. If someone's so depressed that they aren't eating, that they're not meeting their basic hygiene needs. This is someone whose acute depressive symptoms are causing an inability to function. So presence of symptoms causing an inability to function, dangerousness to self, dangerousness to others. And then number three, that hospitalization represents the least restrictive method of care, meaning that there's no way to manage this person safely in an outpatient setting, be it in with their regular psychiatrist or therapist or their regular group or intensive outpatient program. This is someone that needs to come into the hospital and be monitored 24 hours a day until this crisis is over.
And sometimes it's not even admission to an inpatient psych unit. It's admission to a medical floor, as we spoke about before.
Yeah, absolutely. If you're coming to the emergency room, let's say for detox, for example, and hours go by, you're being monitored, and then all of a sudden you develop cardiovascular instability or an alcohol or benzodiazepine withdrawal, yeah, that's somebody that needs to be monitored throughout the clock from a cardiovascular perspective. That's somebody who goes to medicine.
So can you share one of your most memorable patient experiences, of course, without giving away any identifying information, while working in a psych ER?
It's a personality breed. I think people that like emergency room consult work, the sort of on-demand work, aren't your continuity of care people. So they enjoy the sort of adventure, the puzzles, seeing new cases every day. It's different than getting to know someone over the course of many years, their family practice, this kind of stuff. So we accumulate stories, and there's... I don't know. I think there's a level of humor that's kind of dark and is off-putting if you're kind of eavesdropping on emergency room workers one day. One of the first cases I had, my first month on the job, wet behind the ears, you know, my attending sends me out to interview this person, and I read about her behind the door in the office, and she's someone that you might call a frequent flyer, quote unquote, someone who's been to the emergency room dozens, if not 100 times over the course of a couple of years, generally presents with the same story. And this woman would present with a story that her house had burned down, her apartment had burned down, and that she needed help, and so on and so forth. So I go out and I introduce myself. Nervous, I shake my hand, I'm very polite. And she says, I'm trying to get my life together. And I go, that's great. I said, well, how can I be of help? Well, I can't, because my house burned down, and completely loses it, empties her purse on the emergency room floor, and proceeds to strip down completely naked and shout nonsensical things at the window of the emergency room for all to see until security comes in and we have to bring her into the room. This is now, this sounds dramatic, completely an act just to get hospitalized, to have a place to stay, even if it meant being medicated along the way. I hear myself saying the story and it sounds sort of cynical, but I think other emergency room workers might hear that story and go, oh yeah, sure, we got a couple of them. It's jarring and you might miss something. And I remember another case some years later. Middle of the night, I was working a night shift and ER's empty. Me and the nurse are, you know, sort of hanging out, and a patient pops up. And the reason for the visit is SIAH, suicidal ideation, auditory hallucination. In the city, in the middle of the night, if someone presents with SIAH, this is generally drug related. This is generally malingering. Somebody who's kind of representing a severe version of symptomatology for the purposes of hospitalization, for the purposes of shelter, more often than not. So I see the case, I roll my eyes, we invite her in, and I have to eat my hat. This is a young woman who lives in the DC area, who'd started developing ideas of reference, psychotic symptoms, where she felt that television and radio were sending her messages. The messages, about a year ago, were the same as they were presently, and they were to go to New York City to meet the mayor. So she does. She listens to these messages. She travels all the way to New York City, shows up at the state office, and is turned away, of course. These people don't know who this person is, and no, you can't see the mayor. Get out of here. Sitting on the steps late at night, she realizes that these are psychotic symptoms. She can't ignore them anymore. They've dragged her out of her home, hundreds of miles from home, and she wants to die. And so she comes to the hospital and registered with suicidal thoughts and auditory hallucinations. That was a maturing experience for me, because in the ER with a lot of cynical people who like the shift work, who like the hustle and bustle, who like the kind of tough as nails, pedal to the metal kind of stuff, you can get kind of swept up in your biases and make a decision just from reading the complaint. So anyway, she stayed, and a lot of it was education about what's happening and how manageable these symptoms can be and ownership one needs to take.
Do you know what happened to her?
I don't. And that's part of the role. You serve an important role. You have an opportunity to really underscore a point in a person's life, for better or for worse. you try to hope that you point somebody in the right direction. She went upstairs. I was a resident at the time, so we sort of discussed the case. But what happens to her is what happens to lots of people. They get hospitalized. They'll start on a medication depending on the level of understanding, maturity, responsibility that person is able to take or has received. Depends on how they're going to do in those first couple of years after psychotic symptoms present, especially that she was out of state. She probably ran up against resource problems, discharge problems, follow-up problems. So I don't know. I'd like to think she did okay, but you don't know.
And that's an interesting point, because many people who work at different levels of care, in my experience, report that it's hard to not see that the patient's getting better. They see them in this specific level of care, and they may not know what happens to them. And that could be hard on the clinician, I think.
Yeah, you know, I remember a supervisor of mine that was really impactful on me, and I think it was because of where I was in training. It was early on in my training, and I worked a lot of emergency room shifts with this person. He made every encounter important. And I remember being called from the main ER about somebody who, it was a quick discharge. It was a fairly straightforward case. You didn't really need to get into it. And we spent, I don't know, 45 minutes to an hour with this person, really going through this domestic violence situation and what she can do, the safety plan, is sort of assessing her priorities here and her level of interest in change or action. And we walking away, and I was like, why'd you spend so long with that person? Because every encounter is salient. These are people in an emergency room. They didn't generally come by accident. You can leave them with something. And we all have examples of, you know, that one time somebody said that thing to me and I never forgot it. You know, I remember where I was when so-and-so said this thing and I never forgot it. So in an emergency room, you have the opportunity to be like, here's the thing. And that could be something that person never forgets. You can really seize the moment and set somebody right. You can take advantage of the saliency of their being in the emergency room to say something that maybe they've even heard 100 times before, but hearing it in that context, you can really take advantage of how powerful it could be. I've taken that with me.
So what do you think are the positive aspects of being evaluated and treated by a mental health professional in an emergency setting?
I think concretely, it's availability. I think in parts of the country, that's your only access to mental health care. I've worked in lots of emergency rooms, Trenton, Newark, Upper West Side, Midtown, suburban New Jersey, the Bronx, and I'm taking a position working in the rural Midwest, providing sort of video consults, crisis care to ERs that don't have it otherwise. So I think concretely, the psych ER provides an access to a psychiatric evaluation that you couldn't get otherwise. In a resource-rich area like the tri-state, it's not generally the case. You generally see it in more underserved areas where emergency room becomes primary care. And in this way, I think the ER kind of reflects the community around it. Working in these emergency rooms, you have your regulars. You have the things that people tend to present for. Yeah, it sounds a little bit cynical, but you start to get to know the streets around the emergency room itself. You work there long enough. Even the regulars that come in, you may roll your eyes. But I remember I was working in New Brunswick, New Jersey, which was another ER that I worked in. And there was a woman who'd always come in for alcohol, probably hundreds of visits over the course of 10 years or so. And hey, you doing? Yeah, let's call her Carol. Hey, Carol, how are you? Okay, and it became this kind of relationship with her. We were her community. We became the community for a lot of people, financially barricaded in their own city, disadvantaged, beset by medical illnesses and under insurance. So these conditions became chronic, whatever it is. We heard that she died crossing Route 10, and we were genuinely upset. We'd lost somebody. So you argue like, well, what were you doing for that person? Well, right. When they leave the ER, there's little more we're going to do to make sure that they follow a treatment plan or get their things together. But I think the one nice thing about the ER is you can't be turned away. And if you got good people there, that becomes a resource. If I meet somebody for the first time and they've had 11 emergency room visits in the last 6 months, I'd be a lunatic to say, don't go to the emergency room. Say, if you think you need to go to the emergency room, go. If that's part of your safety plan, if you know that you can do that and feel safe, and you've got an emergency room with people actually know you, even better. We'll work on the frequency of ER visits as time goes by. That's not going to happen overnight, but you go. So it's a long, rambling way of saying access to care. That's concretely what ERs provide.
Excellent. So what do you think are some of the pitfalls of being evaluated and treated by a mental health professional in an emergency setting?
It'd be different answers from the clinician side versus the patient side. But I mean, care, right? It's easy to approach that kind of work very sort of conveyor belt. okay, but all right, this is, all right, move them along. All right, admit, and then move, and here's the med, and move along. If you don't look at these cases as individual problems, individual people with very specific things, and you take the time to sort of make it a salient experience, you can get caught in the sort of rote mechanics of it. ERs can wax and wane in terms of how busy they are. If you happen to present on a Monday and it's slammed, you may find yourself waiting hours just to be seen. And any time the ER is stressed, again, those conduits break down. Access to care is often super limited, even in resource-rich places like where you and I have worked. People still may wait days in the emergency room just to be dispositioned to an inpatient unit somewhere in town. That can be a real pitfall.
So what are you most excited about in mental health treatment today?
I'm a little biased because I've been doing it now for a little over a year, but telemedicine is able to provide care, all kinds of schedules in all kinds of areas, where you can create a situation where the clinician isn't burnt out, where they can work hours from home or from their office with a degree of convenience that improves the sense of work-life balance, the investment in work. And when you have happy, rested clinicians, you get better quality care.
That's excellent. That's a great answer, especially from your new experience that you're working with in mental health on telehealth. So if you had a magic wand and could improve one thing about the mental health treatment in emergency care, what would that be?
It comes down to, what do you see the mission of the ER? What do you see that mission being? What's the role of the ER? If I'm looking at the psych emergency room as an access point to care, as a sort of fail-safe, people's last resort or first resort, it's a conduit to care. That's what it is. Yes, you're deciding whether patients need to be hospitalized or discharged, but on either end of those, it's care. It's either inpatient care or outpatient care. And if I see psych ERs as discharging more often than they're admitting, you know, if I had a magic wand, all ERs would just be plugged into good quality intensive outpatient programs, running the gamut from trauma to substance abuse to anxiety to whatever. But if you see the role of the psych ER as an opportunity to funnel people into good quality treatment, to keep them out of emergency services moving forward, to help them live the best lives that they can, ER should be just intimately plugged in. Okay, well, you can start our next cycle of intensive outpatient coming Tuesday. That's a week away. So in the interim, I want to see you back here in the ER for 3 days. In 3 days, rather, we'll do an hour session just to catch up, make sure the meds are doing something for you, if meds are part of the picture or what have you. They generally tend to be in an emergency room setting. But this sort of solid point of contact and a solid conduit to good, high-quality outpatient, intensive outpatient care.
Excellent answer. And then people don't fall through the cracks.
Which they do. It's easy to forget about them once they leave. But if you have a good program to send them to, you can speak of the program and you can see them back in a couple of days. You can really make sure people do it. There's no question that it's better for people to take better care of themselves from everyone's perspective. From the ER's perspective, from hospital administration's perspective, from the person's perspective, from everybody's perspective. It makes sense to help people invest in their health.
And this really goes to what you were saying about it being an extension of the community. If it is an extension and an expression of the community and the culture, why not strengthen it? So can you say a little bit more about that?
It should care about its community. I do think that ERs reflect the community around it. An ER is going to have a different personality from workers to people to whatever. It should be a part of the community. I remember, you know, as a psychiatrist, very frequent reason we're called is for psychosomatic complaints. And you and I know from working on the consult service, we haven't figured 100% of medicine out, and we'll get called for, quote unquote, it's all in their head complaints whenever the imaging and lab results come back, quote unquote, negative. And so much of it is educating people about how to explain negative results and helping people come up with a plan to manage symptoms, this and that. Anyway, so you get these frequent flyers that come in for heart failure, that they're not doing their meds, they're doing this, or the stomach pain or ulcers or what have you. And they're coming in through the ER and they're using the most expensive level of care as a primary care institution. And I remember thinking, a lot of the thing that these people have in common is generally loneliness. There is, if we're talking about psychosomatic stuff, there's the idea that people become invested in remaining symptomatic. If I remain symptomatic, then I get to keep my community of doctors. People will take care of me. I maintain proximity to people. So for a certain subset of patients, they're doctors, their emergency rooms, their outpatient, their doctors, their appointments, their visits become their social network, become their community, and that becomes an investment. I want to maintain this community, and therefore there's somewhat of an incentive to remain symptomatic. I remember thinking, well, why don't we just put a gym next to the emergency room? This is crude. I understand this is crude. But a gym next to the emergency room, and I thought, like, if you got consulted three times for the same symptom within X period of time, then that was too frequent, and we needed to look at what you were doing when you left the emergency room. And if loneliness was a problem, come on down to the gym and hang out with us. And it would just be open hours, and you could come down, and there'd be cards, and we'd have beverages and snacks, and it would just be a place for, again, community. If the ER is a reflection of the community, then open it, then make it. This frequency of contact will help people just invest in their health. When I worked in the IBS clinic, totally, all of them had this sort of, again, it was the community, right? So it was a demographic of people, and let's just get together once a month and hang out. You could share. We were trying to get a group together, but couldn't get the funding, and you know the story. Community makes a big difference. And if the ER is part of the community, then fostering that sense of community should be something that the ER does.
So Dr. Capote, on behalf of myself, my listeners, and all of the people that you have helped through your work, I want to thank you for your contributions to the mental health system.
Thank you for having me. It's been a pleasure.
I'd like to close by reminding our listeners to please subscribe, share, and review this podcast so that you, someone you love, and the people around the world can gain more benefit from mental health treatment. There is no need to suffer in silence. Get the help that you need to build the life that you want.